specializes in the Hebrew Bible and reception, and has written on the relationship between religion, literature, and visual arts, films, and tonight also is going to engage us in conjunction with our campus's showing of the lithographs by Marc Chagall. This morning at 11 o'clock, he focused our attention on some details of Chagall's portrayal of Moses and asked us some interesting questions about the incorporation of Christian sources in other works on the same sort of theme of Exodus at the same time. Sort of puzzling. Tonight, he will extend his train of thought by attending to Chagall's modernism as part of his artistic mix of his vision. So please welcome Professor Tripp.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Professor Hoffman. And I also want to thank Professor Walsh and all of the other organizers who have worked on this project and this invitation. The curator of the exhibit, Sylvia, I don't know your last name.
Savannah.
Savannah, I'm sorry.
Fotin.
So thank you very much for the invitation, and I'm really happy to be here. So as Professor Hoffman just said, the title of tonight's lecture is as this morning, the main title is the same, New Tablets for a New World. That's a phrase from a poem by Chagall. And the subtitle of tonight's lecture, different from this morning, is The Jewish Modernism of Chagall's Moses. So this morning I gave a lecture that tried to place Chagall's Exodus lithographs into their biblical context. I singled out three motifs that might help clarify what Chagall is doing with the Bible: the horns or rays of light coming from Moses' head, the tablets of the law, and the religious objects and garments used for priestly rituals. I nested all that in the larger context of Chagall's puzzling and persistent use of crucifixion imagery, even in a painting titled Exodus. Maybe we can lower the lights now. And I also have to get my pointer out. So this painting called Exodus was completed in the same year as the series that's on display in the gallery. How many of you have seen the exhibit? Okay, if you haven't seen this exhibit, it's a very rare opportunity to see some extraordinary works of art, and the images and reproductions you'll see in my presentation are not faithful at all, I can tell you, having seen the exhibit. So, a painting called Exodus, which, as you see, depicts the Christian crucifixion. And so I raised some questions this morning to think about, get us thinking about how the Jewish orientation of the Exodus series that we have on campus here relates to this most Christian of images, the crucifixion of Jesus. My suggestion this morning was that Chagall's Exodus and crucifixion images share a common concern for religious sacrifice. Just as the sacrifice of the firstborn and the sacrifice of lambs in the book of Exodus provide the foundation for the Jewish tradition of Passover and its Christian makeover as the Last Supper, Passion, and Resurrection. Given this artistic concern for Jewish and Christian sacrifice, I want to suggest that Chagall did not take the approach of either or in his frames of reference, but rather, with great originality and in very surprising and challenging ways, a both and approach. For him, crossing the boundaries of religion and history was just as easy as mixing artistic styles and influences. This morning I mentioned two uncomfortable questions I'm posing about Chagall's biblical art. The first had to do with the crucifixion, a Christian motif, as I said, that shows up all over the place in his work, and very often mixed with Jewish motifs. Here is the second question I'm posing. Is Chagall's biblical art, with its many charming, colorful images taken from Jewish life and folklore, a bit sentimental, trite, nostalgic, or even kitschy? In other words, is Chagall's work great art or a kind of Jewish pop culture? Here's why I ask. I just visited the Detroit Museum of Art, one of the great comprehensive art museums in this country. And even though there were whole rooms dedicated to masters like Picasso, and works by lesser-known modernists like Nadelmann, not one of their Chagall works, and they own many, was on display. Second point about this question. I consulted art historians to prepare for this project, and the three art historians I consulted for this project told me that there is not very much discussion of Chagall in their scholarly world these days. And finally, another tidbit on this question, a recent review of the Polish artist Meyer Kirschenblatt in the Forward, the foremost Jewish newspaper in the United States, describes Kirschenblatt as the anti-Chagall, and the comparison is not very flattering. So the question comes down to whether Chagall is now forgotten or consigned to the margins of history, and should he be? You can already imagine that my answer is no, and you might think it's silly or disrespectful to ask it in the first place. After all, the reputation and achievement of Chagall are monumental, and there's no question that Chagall's work is highly original, which suggests the opposite of anything trite or kitschy. If it's not kitsch, what's he doing? I think this is a fruitful question, because it challenges us to look closely at what he was doing with Judaism, the Bible, Christianity, and modern art. Consider this image from 1914, called Memory or Remembrance, pretty early. Here you see a Jewish peasant with a house on his back, suggesting any number of things. Perhaps the centuries-old tradition of the wandering Jew, rooted in the story of Cain from the book of Genesis, and the long Jewish history of life in diaspora and exile. You may also think of the house as a literal rendering of personal and collective memory, the weight of memory we carry around. But note the physical elements of the image as well. The figure is clearly a man who would look familiar to a resident of Chagall's hometown of Vitebsk, but he is rendered in a flattened, simplified way with geometric shapes that might remind us of cubism. When you look at the face of the man, you might notice its color and wrinkled lines resemble the house on his back. The formal connection between face and house might suggest the kind of outward representation of inner life familiar from Expressionism. These modernist elements combine elegantly in the work to bring our attention to the past, not in a sentimental or nostalgic way, but really to the problem and the experience of the past and memory. Compare this image to one by Chagall's hometown friend, L. Lisitsky. The title of this is Beat the Whites with the Red Wedge, 1920. Lisitsky studied with Chagall at the first Jewish art school in Belarus, and Chagall later hired him to teach at his art academy in Vitebsk. But even though Lisitsky was Jewish, and his early works often depicted Jewish subjects, he joined the suprematist school of modernism, Malevich was another, and became known for his contributions to this kind of utopian art and design. Chagall could have taken this path, or several others into high modernism, but he chose instead to develop in his own direction, a direction I want to describe as Jewish modernism. Now, how does this mix of modernism and tradition play out in the Exodus lithographs? First, I wonder if you noticed the sharp geometric lines of this image of Moses and Aaron in the court of Pharaoh. It isn't really that remarkable by itself, but it's the only image of its kind in the whole collection. This is the scene where Moses appeals to the Egyptian king, "Let my people go." Notice how Chagall places Pharaoh far in the background with the angular shapes in the foreground, looking a little like a modernist artwork. Was he associating high modernism with the opulence of the Egyptian court? As he said in his 1922 autobiography, quote, "Impressionism and cubism are alien to me. Art seems to me to be a state of soul more than anything else, the soul of all that is sacred, the soul of every biped in every place on earth." Let's consider this next image from the Exodus series, which goes along with this early verse from Exodus. This is the verse from the Bible. One day, after Moses had grown up, he went out to his people and saw their forced labor. I'm noticing how much more dim they look from the stuff that you can see in real life, so please do go see these. Like the image called Memory I showed a moment ago, this image features a craggy face and people dressed in peasant clothing. In the context of this biblical story, we can imagine Moses seeing the unjust treatment of the Hebrew slaves and beginning to feel angry, and that something must be done about it. This close-up of Moses' face, which you see in a few other images in the series, invites us to put ourselves in his place. And the contemporary clothing of the slaves might suggest that the injustice of Exodus can be compared to modern injustices. What I find particularly interesting is that some of these workers are smiling. That should surprise us. Here we have that uncanny mix of play and seriousness that I want to note here as one of the complexities of. I also call attention to the style of this image, with its bright colors, simple curvilinear forms, sketch-like quality, and focus on the motion of the workers. Of course, there are some viewers who look at an image like this and say, I could do that. My daughter says that. And others, as you may know, who consider these details, along with all the smiling figures, to indicate a light, happy, and non-serious kind of art. But we know Chagall's style here is a choice, not a reflection of limited technical skill. And we know he can be very serious. So what explains that choice? Here again, I'm in danger of playing amateur art historian, and I don't want to do that. Instead, I want to consider how this image, like so many others by Chagall, contributes something unique, not just to art, but to the tradition of biblical reception, particularly modern Jewish biblical reception. We know that he's not interested in simply illustrating the Bible as popular 19th century artist Gustave Doré did, nor is he interested simply in expressing a set of ideas and feelings that were somehow completely new to the world, as so many other modern artists did. So to address the question, what is he doing, we need to discuss folk and folklore, two concepts that Chagall understood and used in his art. I'll do that, and then I will look at some things Chagall said about his own art, particularly in terms of the Bible and Judaism. And finally, I'll attempt to draw these elements together with what I call Chagall's Jewish modernity. Chagall learned Jewish folk motifs from writers and artists, as well as from personal experience. He was part of a larger cultural movement that was interested in identifying, collecting, and representing Jewish life to a wide audience. So Chagall was neither a naive native nor a disinterested outsider simply collecting and representing folk life. Instead, he concocted a very distinctive style and set of stock images, including floating figures, farm animals, and fiddlers, along with motifs from the Bible. He embraced all these elements under the broader umbrellas of universal ideas of art, the sacred, and love for humanity. But the Jewish foundation for Chagall's vision, taken from experience and from the artists and thinkers of his day, was constant. The most important figure in this movement was the author and scholar from Chagall's own town of Vitebsk, S. Anski, an ethnographer and collector of Jewish folklore best known for writing the play The Dibbuk. That play, by the way, is summarized at the beginning of a movie by the Coen brothers called A Serious Man. The Coen brothers, if you don't know them, are really important to know about. Like others who connect local, marginalized culture to a wider audience, Anski was passionate but self-critical of the project of collecting and disseminating Jewish folklore. Chagall encountered Anski directly in Moscow, where he worked doing set designs and murals for the Yiddish Chamber Theater. And he tells the story of how Anski asked Chagall to stage that play, The Dibbuk, for him. The first production on which Chagall worked there in Moscow was based on three sketches by another Yiddish writer, Sholem Alechem. who was the leader of a modern effort to create and promote Yiddish literature. Yiddish is the Jewish language of Eastern Europe. Alechem's stories about a dairy farmer named Tevye form the basis for a musical you know called Fiddler on the Roof. In the art world, Chagall's teacher Yehuda Penn, who depicted scenes from contemporary Jewish life, was also an influence. Benjamin Harshav describes his long apprenticeship with Penn as follows. Quote, "He learned from Penn the importance of portraying the local world, its houses and fences, and the dignity of Jewish faces and rituals, ethnography as an object of art." The place of Jewish ethnography and folklore in Chagall's work can be seen in this funny and paradoxical notebook entry of Chagall's on Jewish art. And I'll show you the text so we can look at it together. This is Chagall about Jewish art. "But what is really the difference between my crippled Mohilev great-grandfather Siegel, who painted the Mohilev synagogue, and me, who painted the Yiddish theater, a good theater, in Moscow? Believe me, no fewer lice visited both of us as we wallowed on the floor and in workshops, in synagogues, and in theater. Furthermore, I am sure that if I stopped shaving, you would see his precise portrait." As I reflect on this passage, with its humor and simplicity, I see something like a verbal vision of the Exodus lithographs, deceptively simple, but never simplistic. Knowing full well the difference between himself and his great-grandfather, Chagall playfully but also seriously makes his comparison, and in so doing, he evokes a whole series of images and thoughts. I do not know what his great-grandfather's synagogue looked like. It's almost certainly gone. But here is a fine example of a painted wooden synagogue ceiling from a reconstruction in Warsaw of the Gwoziec synagogue. This reproduction of a wooden synagogue ceiling is now in a museum in Warsaw, a museum of Jewish culture and history that opened quite recently. So it's really quite impressive. And you'll see some elements here that might make you think about Chagall's work, the animals perhaps. If Chagall was part of a longer tradition of Jewish art, the Exodus lithographs show us how that tradition looks through the eyes of a modern artist who produced more biblical art than anyone else in his generation. You'll remember that these prints were published in 1966, 10 years after Chagall completed a decades-long project on biblical art, of other biblical art, and 6 years after a second major series of biblical drawings. And the same year, 1966, he donated these images, the Exodus ones, along with series based on the books of Genesis and Song of Songs, to the French government to form what would become the National Museum Marc Chagall Biblical Message, which opened finally in 1973. Here is a diagram of the original plan of that museum. It's hard to see from where you're sitting, maybe, with a description of some of the creation, the contents of the rooms. The creation of man, paradise, Adam and Eve, Noah's Ark, very familiar kinds of motifs, a lot of Jacob and Moses, but also, and unusually, the Song of Songs, which is something that you might not be surprised that he illustrated, but not many other people did illustrate this. Just as the biblical artisan Bezalel was an interest for Chagall as a prototype of the Jewish artist, Moses also gave Chagall inspiration as a model for the Jewish artist. And here's another quote. Chagall, "I have chosen to paint. To me it has been as indispensable as food. Painting appeared to me like a window through which I would fly away to another world. Speaking of that, you will excuse me for recalling the biblical image of Moses, who, in spite of his stammering, was haunted by God so that he would do his duty. In the same way, we are all, in spite of our stammering, pursued by someone so that we will perform our duty." That's from a 1958 address. Perhaps this image of Moses, where we see his face and hands cradling the tablets of the law with the kind of affection you might expect from an artist with his creation, reflects Chagall's image of Moses, like the artist, as one who follows his God-given duty. This unusual mix of personal experience with Jewish folk tradition and art history can be seen in a passage from Chagall's quirky autobiography from 1923. And this is one I won't show, but I'll just read quickly. He's talking about how Judaism influenced his work. He's talking about his family, first of all. If his aunts had angels' wings, they would fly across the market, and maybe you've seen these floating and flying figures, above the baskets of berries, pears, and currants. I have also had a half a dozen uncles or more. They were all good Jews. Some had bigger stomachs and emptier heads, some black beards, others brown. In a nutshell, that's painting. Every Saturday, this is how his autobiography reads. It's kind of free association. It's just very, very creative. Just no way to know where it's going. Every Saturday, Uncle Noy would put on a tallit, any tallit. A tallit is a Jewish prayer shawl, and read the Bible aloud. He played the violin like a cobbler. Grandfather listened and dreamed. Only Rembrandt could have known what the old grandfather, butcher, tradesman, and cantor thought while his son played the violin beside the window, beside the dirty window panes covered with raindrops and finger marks. So again, you get all of this together. You get Rembrandt, you get personal experience, you get a fiddler in his own family, not just from the stories by Alekhine. Another scene from his autobiography, where he visits a famous rabbi to get advice on whether to live in his hometown or move to St. Petersburg, mixes art and religion. After Rabbi Schneerson, who met weekly with followers, tells him to go to St. Petersburg, Chagall protests. And again, I don't have a slide for this, I'll read it to you. "But Rabbi," I say, "I would rather stay in Vitebsk. My parents and my wife's parents live there, you know, there." "Ah, well, my son, since you prefer Vitebsk, I bless you, go there." I would have liked to continue the conversation. I wanted to talk to him about art in general, and mine in particular. Perhaps he would instill a little of the divine spirit into me, who knows? And to ask him if the Israelites are really God's chosen people, as it says in the Bible. And also to know what he thought about Christ, whose pale face had long been troubling me. My God, what sort of a rabbi are you, Rabbi Schneerson? Since then, whatever advice I am given, I do exactly the opposite. With the humor and charm of a Jewish folk tale, Chagall takes on the most respected religious authority of his community. And as I said this morning, the son of that rabbi became so famous and so influential that some of his followers began to think of him as the Messiah. And the movement he created is now a sort of global movement for spreading Orthodox Judaism around the world. So even in challenging the tradition, by the way he tells the story, Chagall also reaffirms it. Unorthodox, modern, and universal, but also very personal and Jewish, Chagall's Bible furnished him with endless artistic possibilities. And this text I will show you, because it's relevant, most relevant of all. So, here's Chagall on the Bible. "But if you would read the Bible and the Psalms, you would find everything. Even the best thesis on art and on life." And let me just digress for a second. That's also very rabbinic. That's a very Jewish thing to say, that the Bible contains everything, or the Torah contains everything. "I would not like to hear people say, while listening to me speaking of love in the realm of art, that I am pursuing a theological or social idea. No. Underlining those elements with love in mind, I have no ism in sight. In our times, when a great deal is said about the decay of religion, art itself is transformed into a stream of technicalities in a matching series of ways, and in spite of all that, it does not have the strength to bring about a miracle, that is to say, to give us in exchange another message." We can see this perspective on the Bible and art in the Exodus lithographs, with their rudimentary but expressive renderings of Moses, Aaron, and others, which operate more at the level of myth than history, comprising images whose simplicity suggests archetypes from the ancient past that remain fully activated in the present. Chagall was many things. The scholar Benjamin Harshaw puts it this way: we cannot ask what Chagall is in any exclusive way, because from his text we learn that he is all of it, French and Russian and Jewish all at the same time. And he is both pro-communist and pro-Zionist, as well as opposed to those ideologies. Simultaneously a revolutionary artist and a critic of avant-garde formalism. Chagall was not at all fuzzy or compromising about it. He did not blur the boundaries, but he developed his own polyphony and expressed his convictions decisively, depending on the context of his discourse and relationship. Oxymoron, ambiguity, and paradox are key characteristics of modernism in literature and art, and Chagall carried them to the identity level. So while Harshav, quoted just now, sees a unity of many distinct elements in Chagall himself, I would add that Chagall relates this same unity also to the Bible, which he regarded as a kind of world in itself and a reservoir of universal human experience and wisdom. You can see this complex modern unity of opposing elements in a work that treats Moses as a kind of primordial giant who incorporates Chagall's fiddler, a village, a clock, and a figure suggestive of a crucified Christ. This is 1964-65, so around the same time as our Exodus lithographs, and it's called composition. I hate it when things are called composition because I don't learn anything what they're thinking when they made it, but there it is. You can see all those elements then, and again, Moses as this sort of primordial giant encompassing somehow those things. And I'm sure there's a better reproduction somewhere, but I couldn't find it. I know I'm going out on a limb by suggesting a label, Jewish modernism, to describe Chagall. What I mean by Jewish modernism is this: Chagall emphatically and consistently affirmed Jewish imagery and tradition in his distinctly modern art. His Jewish modernism was never sectarian, tribal, or orthodox, but he never abandoned Jewish tradition and his own sense of Jewish identity. Chagall's Judaism spanned the biblical and the modern, the secular and the orthodox, and though he visited the Holy Land, even before it became the State of Israel, Chagall's Jewish world remained the childhood experience of family life in the town of Vitebsk. It would take more time and research to spell out what exactly Jewish modernism might mean, but it starts with Chagall's personal identity as a Jewish artist from Vitebsk, which includes the lived experience and its representation in art that draws freely, selectively, and non-dogmatically from all sorts of modernism. Finally, this Jewish modernism emerges later, by the time of the Exodus lithographs, as a universal expression of love through a highly distinctive vision. To repeat a phrase from the essay I quoted a little while ago, quote, "With love in mind, I have no ism in sight." Instead of trying to refine this idea of Jewish modernism with more words, let me try to illustrate it with some of the lithographs, taking Chagall's bold use of color, red and very dark colors, and the motifs of angels and crowds. The reddest image in the Exodus series corresponds to a very important episode, the conflict with the Amalekites in chapter 17 of the book of Exodus. If you don't know, the Amalekites are the perennial enemies of Israel, the bad guys who keep coming back generation after generation. They come to symbolize evil in the Bible and Jewish tradition. So it's interesting to see how Chagall portrays this scene, with a wild-eyed Moses commanding a soldier who looks like a medieval knight to fight the Amalekites, and all of this dressed in blood red and standing under a red sun. Dark colors, something Chagall studied in one of his favorite artists, Rembrandt, provide a dramatic setting for the plague of darkness imposed on Egypt, setting off Moses' bright clothing, staff, and beams of light. The greens and blues of the image, along with the turmoil of the figures below, suggest the kind of distorted vision and disturbance people experience when the sky suddenly turns dark. Similar colors and similar effects are used in these two images with angels. First, of Moses destroying the tablets on the left, and then of him instructing the Israelites to follow their teachings on the right. So again, that light and dark, I think, are characteristic. It's interesting to note the angelic figures above carrying Torah scrolls. So this here and this here, those are Torah scrolls. So in every synagogue, the first five books of the Bible, called the Torah, are handwritten in a special way, and then that Torah scroll is used every week in the liturgy and given a place of honor in the space of the synagogue. And it's interesting just to see these two here showing up, connecting the tablets of the law and the story of Exodus in the ancient biblical story to the later Jewish tradition of writing those same commandments down on scrolls. These angels, one in human form and another more of a winged horse perhaps, suggest a great deal of freedom in Chagall's artistic imagination. A final motif I'd like to point out, one that may help illustrate Chagall's Jewish modernism, is his crowds. Unlike the casts of thousands we came to know from Hollywood epics like the Ten Commandments, Chagall's crowds are somewhat homely or motley, composed of individuals whose humanity and vulnerability are more important than their unity. Whether they're crossing the Red Sea, and I'm going to move a little faster here, so whether they're crossing the Red Sea, worshiping a golden calf, gathered at the foot of the cross with Moses, and if you don't see him yet, Moses is down here, there. Or following a pillar of cloud. The people of Chagall's crowds share hope and risk in equal measure. The mixing of biblical and post-biblical elements in these crowds, in clothing, for example, points to Chagall's confidence that art and religion go together, and that the Bible provides a nearly infinite resource for bringing people together through the centuries. I hope Jewish modernism sounds like an oxymoron to you, a contradiction in terms, or at least a paradox, because that's what it is. Judaism, after all, has been around for over 3,000 years, and modernism was almost always violently anti-religious. That's the marvel of Chagall for me. Let me try to capture that paradox with the help of Abi Warburg, an influential art historian of the 20th century. Arguing that the study of civilization can be strengthened by an alliance between the history of art and the study of religion, Warburg showed how ancient traditions survived in later ones, and how religion survived even in secular art. He believed that old formulas and motifs came back again and again in art history and carried earlier religious images and ideas with them. For Warburg, early modernity resisted the influence of pre-modern magic and religion, but unwittingly carried the traces of that pre-modern world. Like Chagall, Warburg believed modern scholars and artists needed to pay more attention to the hidden ways that past religion lives on in the present, even the secular present. But for Chagall, those traces had become too faint to protect against the dramatic, often violent transformations sweeping Europe. Against the overwhelming tide of modernists who wanted to sweep tradition away and destroy the ideas of past masters and traditions, Chagall championed tradition, biblical Jewish tradition in particular, and he found ways to combine it with modernist techniques. Like Walter Benjamin, a German Jewish thinker whose work has been a focus of mine, Chagall engaged with the Bible in order to show us how modernism inherits religious traditions. The many artistic influences on Chagall, from Michelangelo and Rembrandt to Cézanne, Matisse, Picasso, and many others, did not prevent him from celebrating and embracing something none of them did, a self-conscious inheritance of biblical Jewish tradition in a present that, as we now know, could never be fully secular. If one of Chagall's deep interests in the book of Exodus was the motif of sacrifice, His Exodus lithographs of 1966 showed how sacrifice could lead to the kind of community and promise we see in this final image of the pillar of cloud, Moses with the tablets, and the people of Israel. As I have said, Chagall was not interested in simply illustrating the book of Exodus as Doré and so many others had done, nor was he presenting the Exodus as ancient history. Instead, through what I'm calling his Jewish modernism, he selected striking and often rarely cited episodes from the book to accompany his series. The freshness and vibrancy of his images convey something at once immediate and mythical. Just as the Jewish Passover and its Christian counterpart, the Eucharist, transcend time, making the past of the Exodus or the Last Supper somehow present, so Chagall's images, by their simplicity, directness, and use of modern techniques, convey the Exodus as a myth that seems as vivid and true today as it has for centuries. But our world is full of conflict and contradictions. For example, between tradition and modernity, Judaism and Christianity, religion and secularity, the individual and the group, joy and sorrow. Great art, like great religion, does not so much reconcile these opposites as illuminate them. I think Chagall's art is great in this way, and by no means kitschy or sentimental. Did Chagall sometimes paint too much, too quickly, or repeat himself too often? Perhaps. He made it look easy. And for some of us who have seen his work and its many imitators for many years without really looking at it closely, the sheer volume, charm, and apparent ease of Chagall's compositions may prevent us from seeing how much he shows us, how many of the contradictions of our world he points out. If I have one concern about this work, it's this quality of accessibility, which sometimes tricks me into thinking there isn't much to it. But that may be more the fault of the viewer than the artist. For Chagall did not gloss over evil and suffering. If he strove to overcome contradictions for the sake of hope, he also blurred distinctions in confronting catastrophe. In a 1950 poem I quoted from this morning called For the Slaughtered Artists, the voice speaking in the poem describes the death and misery of the war, World War II. And asks in the manner of biblical lament, how should I shed tears? And the poem continues, I see the torn out hair, the pulled out teeth. They overwhelm me with my rabid palate. I stand in the desert before heaps of boots, clothing, ash and dung, and mumble my Kaddish. Kaddish is a prayer of mourning. And then, like a biblical lament, there is a hesitant turn in the poem toward hope. And as I stand from my paintings, the painted David descends to me, harp in hand. He wants to help me weep and recite chapters of Psalms. After him, our Moses descends. He says, don't fear anyone. He tells you to lie quietly until he again engraves new tablets for a new world. Chagall's reference to the Psalms of Lament and his own art gives way to the most iconic figure of all, the lawgiver whose justified anger at the golden calf leads him to break the first tablets of the covenant before he produces a second set. The poem seems to compare the destruction of the war, the Holocaust, the murder of so many innocent victims, including artists, with the worship of the golden calf in Exodus. And at the same time, it represents Moses as a source of hope, whose new tablets for a new world may suggest an apocalyptic fulfillment of justice and goodness. These tablets are new and ancient at the same time, since he produced new ones in the Bible. Those new tablets were accompanied by the covenant formula proclaiming divine mercy in the episode of Moses' shining skin and the horns of light, which are illustrated here as well. In other words, new tablets may very well be modern, but they are also an ancient idea that returns every time the story of Exodus is told. Thank you.
reflect a little bit, ask questions, and engage in some dialogue that things you wonder about, issues that came up.
Yes. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. I've been doing some reading, and I can't remember where I read it. Some historical sort of reconstruction of Moses as a military general, sort of, you know, marching towards Jericho. And I wonder if, given that the political events of Chagall's lifetime, if he ever played with that idea of Moses, you know, in some sort of military or command role.
I mean, I think you could see that in some of these lithographs. Here, for example, but also perhaps more so, let's see, perhaps more so here in the Red Sea crossing. In both of the examples here, just this one and the last one, it's a dual agency. There are two authorities here, and Chagall seems pretty careful about showing that Moses, and this is also a concern in the biblical account, the Bible seems very eager to show that Moses is not a solo artist. He's really acting under divine command, and it's interesting that you mentioned commander, because that scene of the burning bush where he's commanded to take his sandals off or his shoes off is reiterated in the book of Joshua, when Joshua is also identified as this, he's like the military commander after Moses. He also is commanded that scene is reenacted. He's commanded to take his shoes off and observe a certain kind of humility in front of the divine presence. So the biblical account is pretty careful to prevent the audience, the reader, from thinking Moses is a kind of Alexander the Great type guy. And I think Chagall is also sensitive to that as well. That is a very good question. Another way to think about your question is to think about Chagall's relationship to the creation of the State of Israel, which happened during his lifetime. And as I mentioned, either now or this morning, he first visited there in 1931, and he continued visiting a number of times. But as I also mentioned, his own artwork, the Jewish identity and content of his artwork focused more on the world he grew up in Vitebsk in Belarus. And for whatever reason, and again this would be something to explore, he did not go 100% in that direction. In the Zionist imaginary, the State of Israel, one of the great figures besides Joshua was actually Samson. And there's a nice little book by the Israeli writer David Grossman on the figure of Samson as a kind of inspiration for the use of force and strength in defending the Jewish people or the biblical Israel. Doesn't feel like that's the exact aim of these images, but there's certainly an element of it, and there's also always an ambivalence about it. And that ambivalence, I would argue, is biblical. The Bible is very eager the burial place of Moses is never disclosed. It's secret. And his life is limited at the year 120 years, even though it says he was ready to keep going at the end of the book of Deuteronomy. And so it seems like the authors of the Bible wanted their readers not to think of Moses as a kind of substitute for God. There'll be time for both. Go ahead.
I just wanted to know, I wondered about whether the fact that Chagall's work is based on the Bible, if that has something to do with the fact that it's not hung or not put in a prominent place in the discussion of art, modern art. I wondered if you think there's any connection there.
You mean the fact that I didn't see any Chagall in the Detroit Museum?
Yep.
If the fact that there's a lot of religion in it,
yeah.
You know, that could be. It's an anecdotal observation, and I just happened to be in that museum for the first time, which is truly a great museum and large. So there's, and they own a lot of Chagall. Yeah, it'd be an interesting hypothesis to test. Is there a certain kind of discomfort with the fact that there's religious content that makes it seem a little weird compared to other? He doesn't fit in, and that's what I think I was hearing from my art historian friends, that he doesn't fit into the overall story of modernism. The story of modernism would be much more happy showing us the work of Elazitsky, right? And that's modernism. And so where does Chagall fit in? Did he sort of fail? Is he kind of a failed modernist because he didn't have the nerve to produce this kind of stuff? That his friend, they were friends.
Yeah.
It's not like he was from a different place.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a nice question. It'd be fun to test that. I'm not sure how, but it'd be fun to.
Yeah.
There's certainly there's a secularist bias among some people in the world of modernism. Yes.
What role do you think that, especially in the Exodus things, what God am I who play? Whenever I see these, you know, groups of shtetl Jews in the middle of Exodus, I think about that the moment in the Passover Crusader when the Haggadah instructs everyone who's celebrating Passover to act as if it happened to them.
Yeah.
Well, it's hard not to see that.
So the question, what role does
the Haggadah?
The Haggadah play? Yeah, well, Moses never shows up in the Haggadah. So it's an interesting, that's a question that people ask, why isn't Moses in the Haggadah? And it may go to this other earlier question about the desire to keep Moses from rising into a sort of semi-God figure. But I think the crowds are an acknowledgement of that. You know, there's that phrase I think you're talking about in the Haggadah, it's as if we were slaves,
yes,
in Egypt.
That's right.
Yeah, and even in the debates and national debates recently about immigration, there were Jewish protesters who were quoting the Book of Exodus. We were once slaves too, or we were strangers in a strange land. And so this emphasis in the Passover celebration. What I tried to talk about is the past and the present kind of coming together,
right,
in the ritual. It's explicit in that phrase. And I think it's also one of the reasons why you see peasant clothing that would have looked familiar to the person living in Eastern Europe in the 20th century. Yeah. And again, much more. I was trying to figure out if anyone knows what this activity was. Maybe it's the making of the bricks. It was easier to see in the actual image, and I was looking at the actual image today. But yeah, that does come to mind, and I think that's quite intentional on Chagall's part. Of course, Christian artists had done this for a long time as well. They used contemporary clothing and architecture to illustrate biblical stories, and so. But they're
sometimes to show them paying for it. I mean, you think about the Umar Road altarpiece.
That's
where
true.
The
Yeah. The essay, Chagall's essays show a lot of self-awareness about how relatively modest the great Jewish art is compared to the sort of museums full of Christian art. And so he's thinking and talking a lot about that contribution he would like to make. But he does it without disavowing those great artists. He loves them. He just wants to love everyone. He seems very, 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 very all-embracing. Other questions? Yes?
So I keep thinking about this construct of Jewish modernism and trying to think about other characters, other figures that might fit into this category. So would you put, say, Sholem Aleichem or Franz Kafka or Freud, because these are people I would put in modernism,
mm-hmm,
and they're Jewish. So what else do you have to do to fit into that,
yeah,
category? How does this, does it only apply to Chagall? How can we make this
right,
a thing?
Yeah, thanks. No, I think it would definitely fit Kafka. And I think now that we know how much Freud knew and thought about Judaism, Freud would fit there as well. Sholem Aleichem too, because he's not a native simply reporting.
Mm-hmm.
He's an artist representing. And I.B. Singer, and so,
yeah.
Yeah, all across, sure, and all the way down to Saul Bellow.
Yeah.
It's a very rich list of literary modernists. As far as visual artists go, I don't know enough. I need to learn more. I know there are others. I don't know if Nadelman is a Jewish modernist or just a modernist. Modigliani, I don't know. Is there something quite Jewish about his work? Even Elazitsky, though you wouldn't know it from this work, did a number of explicitly Jewish things in some of his work. Or would it even have to be? You know, that would be the discussion.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks for that. Yes.
I'd like to pay a close attention to the Red Sea image of Chagall. You mentioned the cloud takes an important role, and to me, it looks like a perspective, like above the sky, looking down on the people. And is it possible to say this picture is reflecting the modern hermeneutic, like reading the Bible in this way? I mean,
that's nice.
Thank
you. No, the question about whether this is a perspective from above looking down, which it must be, or at least from quite a distance, raises for you the question of whether it's also a kind of hermeneutics of, what was it?
Hermeneutics of, perspective to look at biblical texts is a bit special to me.
Yeah. That's actually very helpful because, I mean, one of the things I've been struggling with this series, or trying to understand, in a series that he produces this work at the same time as he's producing this more upsetting work, which shows a lot of images of suffering and destruction, as well as the Christian crucifixion. What is he doing in this series? And it could be that what you're saying is that he's chosen a kind of distance, and a very distant one at that. The language I was offering in the talk suggested myth, that it's almost as if he's rendering the Book of Exodus as myth, as opposed to history, and also not as a kind of literal illustration. There's no interest at all in a comprehensive or literal illustration. But maybe with the help of your idea of the distant overview from, again, I'm looking for the Red Sea, there it is, we could think of it that way. It's as if you could even see these as illustrations for a Passover Haggadah or for a Christian retelling of the Exodus story. From a great distance, the story as, these are not three-dimensional, they're flattened figures. And color seems to be very important as well as line, but the color here, I was trying to understand why there are two groups of people here, yellow of Moses matching the yellow here of people at this stage of the Red Sea crossing, then separating them as an angel, again holding a Torah scroll. So interesting, it suggests again this kind of, there's already a Torah. Right, there's already a synagogue somewhere, and then this second column of people in the distance, further along as they cross, but there with the help of an angel. Yeah, all of that seems very distant, very a distant perspective, certainly. Yeah, thanks for that. Other questions? Any question is fair. From the students, let's have at least one question from a student.
Of all the paintings that you went through today, which one would you say is your favorite?
My favorite? Yes. Because I need some optimism in my life right now. It's that last one. That pillar of cloud, that large one.
Why is that?
Let me just show it and then I can't do two things at once. And also I'm trying to think of a smart answer to your very good question. Why do I like it? Okay. I like it. It's partly like answering the question, why do I like pizza? I don't know. I just really like pizza. So to be honest, that's part of the answer. The other part of the answer is that I see there's a lot of roundness in these faces. I find it somehow pleasing, inviting. I can see myself there somehow. I see diversity and unity at the same time. I love the way he does crowds because it's not the crowd that's scary of people who are going to do something violent, and it's not a crowd of everybody being exactly the same. There are people who are distracted. This figure is distracted and looking a different direction. There are different kinds of clothing, different kinds of... This one again, there's the Torah scroll again. Just happened to be there, just like popped up. I love the colors. A lot of what I think we see is he likes to use a relatively simple primary colors. And so I guess I like the... What I was trying to get at in my own response in the talk was something that looks quite simple, but when you examine it further, gets me thinking more and more complex ideas. And so that's the difference for me between a classic work of art or a classic work in any way and something that's not going to be around next year. This will be around next year for me, I think, because while it does look simple, and you could, I bet at least one of you has heard someone say, I could do that, right? That's childish. While people might say that, I think it's still going to be around because, again, this is, if you know his work, he's always showing these floating figures. Are they, what are they? I keep having new questions. It makes me think. The philosopher Paul Ricoeur says, the symbol gives rise to thought. And if the painting is a symbol, it makes me think. It brings me back over and over again. The classic is something you go back to over and over again at different times. Does that answer your question? And how do people convey that excitement? How do people share their love of something? They muddle through it like I just tried to do. And maybe that rubs off on you, or maybe you walk away and think, I feel sorry for that guy. He's wasting his time looking at these ugly things. Thanks for your question. Yes? I think it's a very affectionate relationship from what I've observed. There are a lot of imitators of Chagall. I think one of the problems I had understanding his work is that there are so many imitations. This was completely new when it was done. You don't see anything like it when he's doing it. And he intentionally walked away from, in a way, it's as if he were a movie star, and he could have done 100 romantic comedies and made millions of dollars doing that, and he walked away from those cubists and suprematists and other sort of extreme new idea modernists with ideological formulas and manifestos. He walked away from that and did his own thing, and a result of that is that for some reason, a lot of people really loved it and imitated it. So I think that whether it's in Jewish communities, illustrations that are used in Jewish communities, I don't know much about the Jewish reception of Chagall's art, except just to say that in my observations, I've noticed a lot of imitations of Chagall's style in what you could call Judaica, sort of Jewish art and objects. Decorative objects. Does that answer the question? Yeah, I'd like to know more about that myself. One could imagine, resistance. Chagall shows a lot of crucifixions. He
He doesn't embrace a strict orthodox practice of Judaism. He doesn't have any interest in that at all. He rejects that. And he's not particularly reliable on any political position, for Israel, against Israel, for communism, against communism. I find that to be true often, that artists are not very reliable sources of political wisdom. I think that's true of celebrities sometimes too. So that's an interesting question. I'd like to know more about that.
Well, thank you so much. If you have other sort of questions you want to stay behind, that's fine.